All right, I think we can start. So, and the rest will tune in as we go, I'm sure. Welcome everyone to this seminar, which is a part of an optimal seminar series on energy optimization and learning. So today we are hosting Helena Lecard. Thank you, Helena, for accepting our invitation. It's a great pleasure to host you here. And Helena, she is a permanent researcher at INRIA Lille, North Europe, in France. And we know Helena thanks to her contributions to algorithmic game theory, optimization, machine learning, and forecasting, with applications to power systems and more specifically to transmission distribution coordination and peer-to-peer electricity markets, and applications to telecommunication networks and economics. And before joining INRIA Lille North Europe, Helena worked as assistant professor at École des Mines de Paris at Sophia Antipolis, France. And she was also a visiting researcher at the Center for Operations Research and Econometrics at University Catholique of Louvain in Belgium. And Helena expressed her wish to make this seminar as interactive as possible. So please feel free to unmute yourself, ask your questions, or drop them into chat, and I will pass them on. And I think we can start. So yes, Helena, please, the stage is yours.
Okay, thank you, Vladimir, for the nice introduction. So I'm Hélène Lecadre, I'm a researcher at INRIA Lille Nord Europe. In this talk, I will give an overview of an algorithm that we developed to compute equilibrium of generalized Nash equilibrium problem. So I will give an overview of the problems, the methods, and then I will present an application related to a peer-to-peer energy trading market. And we will discuss specifically the impact of privacy on generalized Nash equilibrium. So feel free to interrupt me if you have questions. Need to change slides. Okay. So my talk will be divided as follows. And so I will start by presenting broadly my research activities. Then I will give an overview of equilibrium problems. I will describe our problem. I will give an overview of the algorithm we have developed and that is based on a proximal method. I will extend the formulation to a bounded rationality setting and frame the problem in an equilibrium selection framework. And I will go back to an application discussing why generalized Nash equilibrium problems are important and assessing the impact of privacy on generalized Nash equilibrium. So to give an overview of my research activity, I'm working on mathematical models of intelligent agent decision makings. I'm specifically work on algorithmic approaches to shape the outcome of competitive and cooperative interactions. My research interests methodologically at the intersection of game theory, learning, and optimization. And I have interest for applications in link with networks, smart grid, and learning-based markets. So I will start by giving an overview of equilibrium problems. In general, this class of problems are difficult to solve. First, because the existence of solution is not guaranteed. They might give rise to a multiplicity of solutions, even in some cases, an infinity of solutions. So to provide a meaningful economic interpretation, it is important to describe as accurately as possible the set of solutions. But spanning the set of solutions is generally difficult because indeed it can be infinite. It can present some discontinuities. So it's a tough task. So in this context, selection of equilibrium is needed, relying on criteria such as stability, efficiency, fairness. But it's generally hard to select equilibrium. A certain number of approaches exist in the multi-agent literature, providing methods or algorithms to force the agent to coordinate on, for example, Pareto optimal equilibrium. But practically, they are hard to enforce. There exist various approaches from the literature and to solve equilibrium problems. So first, analytical approaches, but they are possible only for a few classes or very simple form of games. It is also possible to exploit the game properties, relying on structures and like the existence of a potential function, submodularity. So it's possible for certain classes of games. Best response algorithms have also given rise to a large literature, but their convergence proof is difficult even for very simple form of games. And finally, there is a large part of the literature that is interested in distributed gradient descent algorithms and prove their convergence under a set of strong assumptions and typically in the setting of aggregative games, which is also a specific form of non-cooperative generalized Nash equilibrium problems. So to give an overview of the set of application of the algorithm that we have developed today, so our goal is to solve generalized Nash equilibrium problem. So it's a specific form of non-cooperative game. In fact, it's a broader set of non-cooperative game. It's specific in the sense that it involves coupling, possibly between the utility of the agents, but also between the feasibility set of the agents. So typically, this class of non-cooperative static games is used to model underlying competition between agents that are linking by networks. And typically, the coupling constraints model some capacity limitation of the line and joining the agents, or possibly represent some physical rules, and like the expression of Kirchhoff law in power systems. So I guess you are all familiar with that. So the set of algorithms that have been developed to solve generalized Nash equilibrium problems is quite wide. They can be decomposed into two subclasses: centralized algorithms that are typically based on classical optimization methods that can be applied, but only if the game has a variational can be reformulated through a variational inequality. And this is only possible if the game has a potential structure. So this is possible only for a very specific form of generalized Nash equilibrium problem. In case this reformulation is not possible, some distributed algorithms have been developed, and like best response, distributed gradient descents. I have already spoken about it. This algorithm to converge requires strong assumption on the game, as I already told, a typically strong monotonicity of the pseudo-gradients, which in practice it might be difficult to verify. So what we want to do here is that we want to develop a distributed algorithm which converge under non-restrictive assumption on the game. And we want also to frame this algorithm such that it enables equilibrium selection. So to formalize the setting, yes, generalized Nash equilibrium problem, we introduce them as a non-cooperative game G, static. We consider a set N of N players. We introduce Xn as a set of strategy of agent N that check a local constraint captured through a function phi N. And we introduce pi N as the utility of agent N. So each agent N solves a parameterized optimization problem with local constraints and a global coupling constraint here captured from this function k. So this function k is shared between the player. They each have the same view of this function k. But associated with this global coupling constraint, there is a dual variable, lambda n here, that I've represented as classical in the electricity market literature between brackets on the right. So in this literature, there are many interpretations of this dual variable in terms of price. I will come back again to this meaningful interpretation. But broadly, in fact, this dual variable captures somehow the valuation that the agents have of this coupling constraint. And different agents might have different valuation of the same coupling constraint. So our goal is, so by these different evaluation, in fact, they give rise to the set of generalized Nash equilibria. I will detail it in more detail. Our goal is to provide an algorithm to select equilibria from this set based on specific system-wide criteria and to prove the convergence of the algorithm. So I recall a standard solution concept that are useful to interpret the outcome of the algorithm. X is a variational equilibrium if it is solution of the non-cooperative game G that I have introduced previously, and that the dual variable associated with the coupling constraints are aligned between the agents. So to emerge somehow, this variational equilibrium requires a strong coordination between the agents that is typically enforced through a coordinator or a third-party player. And in many applications, this might be that might be difficult to justify. Normalized Nash equilibrium is another solution concept, and which is a refinement of generalized Nash equilibrium. And it assumes that for each player evaluation, lambda n, there exists a coefficient Rn that maps a valuation to a common valuation lambda. So the coefficient Rn is somehow the ratio of the global valuation that is identical between, between all the agents and the local valuation of the agent lambda n. So as we will see later, this parameter is this coefficient Rn is quite important because we will use it to parameterize our algorithm. So to come back to the interesting economic interpretation that can be that can come out of these dual variables, if we consider a very simple two-node network, the two nodes being linked by a line with finite capacity. In each node, we have an agent, and the problem between the two agents is represented as a generalized Nash equilibrium problem. Then this lambda n, is, if you take the electricity market literature, can be interpreted as a locational marginal price or a nodal price. If price discrimination is allowed, then the price charged to the agents might be different. And in that case, the normalized Nash equilibrium is an appropriate solution concept. And also in that case, from an economic point of view, the nodes and the agents in the node will be charged based on their contribution to the line congestion, which somehow can be seen as more fair than the case in which price discrimination is not allowed. So this means that there is some coordination in the determination of the price that are charged to the agents. And in that case, variational equilibrium is an appropriate solution concept. So the two solution concepts that I have introduced to interpret the outcome of generalized Nash equilibrium problem can be somehow linked with the type of pricing that is in place on the network. So I make the assumption that the utility functions of the agent, pi n, are concave in the strategy of the agents, that the local constraint set xn is non-empty, compact, convex, and that the global constraint set is non-empty. So under this set of assumptions, I recall the standard result from Rosen that explains somehow the framing of our algorithm. So Rosen proved some time ago that the set of variational equilibria is included in the set of generalized Nash equilibria, and that for any value of the vector R that contain this Rn coefficients that I have introduced previously, there exists a normalized Nash equilibrium that is solution of the non-cooperative game G that I have introduced previously. So this means that by making R varying, we can expect to generate multiple equilibrium solution of the generalized Nash equilibrium problem. So as a result, as we will see, we will parameterize our algorithm in R, and the goal will be to make R varying so that we can describe multiple solutions. So in this talk, I will give the broadest formulation of the problem. Yeah? So in that setting, we assume that the agents are bounded rational. So to give you an illustration, let's assume that the N agents are on a network, but they do not have the same view of the network. So they do not share all the information on the network. Some agents have only a local view on the network. Yeah? Mathematically, this is transformed by the fact that the coupling constraint become local, and it is now captured by a function Km that is private to agent n. So each agent n has to solve a parameterized optimization problem in which the coupling constraint is now local and captured through a function Km. So this function Km, we make the assumption that it is linear in the strategy of the agent and also in the vector of strategy of all the other agents. The coefficient that is put in front of the strategy of the agent N, in the case we have a scalar in strategy, is private to agent N and not shared with the other agents. And the vector of strategy, the vector of coefficient that is put in front of the vector of strategy of all the other agents is an estimation that agent N makes of the coefficients of the other agents. So this setting gives rise to two scenarios, so a scenario of complete information in which all the agents share their coefficients. And in that case, the estimate that agent N has of the coefficients, the vector of coefficient to put in the other agent, in front of the other agent vector strategy is aligned with their coefficients. And an incomplete information setting in which the estimated coefficients might be biased. So what we want to do is that we want to solve this non-cooperative game with bounded rationality. And to do that, we observe first that if we want to solve it directly, it requires enormous coordination between the agents, which in practice might be very difficult to enforce. Indeed, you have a coupling constraints here that depend on the strategy of all the agents. So it might be really tricky to impose such coordination. So what we want to do instead is to rely on a hierarchical decomposition of the problem. And to do that, we start by solving the lower level of the problem. So the idea is, at the lower level, is to reformulate the bounded rationality game, GB, as a dual game that will be uncoupled. So to do that, we introduce Ln as the Lagrangian function of associated with the parameterized optimization problem of agent N. And we define the dual uncoupled game that each agent N solves. And this is a min-max optimization problem in which the objective is replaced by the Lagrangian. So we have relaxed the coupling constraint of agent N by putting it directly in the objective of agent N. And this min-max problem is parameterized in the coefficient Rn, as you can see. So to solve this, dual game, our idea is to rely on a proximal method. So typically in the literature, there are wide application of the alternative direction method of multiplier, so ADMM, to compute equilibrium for non-cooperative game without coupling constraints. So I recall as the basic structure of vanilla ADMM. So it's decomposed in three steps, and first an initialization step, then a communication steps in which each agent communicates or estimates to all the other agents, and an update step in which each agent updates a primary variable following the augmented Lagrangian. And a coordinator computes the updated dual variables and send them as a signal in case of price interpretation to the agents. The problem with this formulation is that it requires lots of information exchange between the agents, and also privacy issues might hinder the implementation of such semi-decentralized algorithm. So what we want to do is that we want to frame this algorithm in a fully distributed setting. This is what we have done in our paper. So we have formulated a parameterized algorithm that is now fully distributed in the sense that it does not require the intervention of a coordinator. So we have an initialization step again. We have a communication step that relies on the definition of a graph of communication that is given as input of the problem. And using this, this graph, each agent communicates or estimates only with her neighbors. And then an update steps in which each agent updates our primal variables and dual variables using the augmented Lagrangian, but only locally. So there is no intervention of a coordinator anymore.
Helen, quick question about this picture and maybe the previous slides. This parameterization R, right? Does it relate to the agent's private estimate of information about other agents?
No. The R vector, it relates to a, to normalize Nash equilibrium. So this R, it links the local evaluation of the agent with a common valuation. But at the same time, it's also in line indeed with how they estimate the coefficient of the others, because indeed their local valuation, their lambda n, is the dual variable that is associated with the local coupling constraints. But itself depends on their estimation of the others' coefficients. But there is no explicit link between the two, a priori.
Thank you. Thank you.
Dr. Likal, I also have a question.
Yes.
You mentioned that the, in a few slides before, that private information, private metrics, in one of the linear equations. So at what point of this algorithm, those private matrices are revealed? I mean, or estimated, or they share the private information with other agents to come to a equilibrium.
Yes, so the initial estimate that the agents have here, if we are in an incomplete setting, they stay as they are. So there is a bias, an initial bias that does not change. But in the course of the algorithm, the agents share information with their neighbors. But there is information here, and it's mostly their primal variable update and dual variable update. It's not a direct sharing of their estimate of the coefficients.
Okay, thank you.
So clearly, their primal and dual variable update depend on these coefficients estimate, but they do not share it directly.
Okay, I see. Thank you.
Okay. So we have formulated as a local optimization problem that each agent has to solve. It's as I explained before, this is a min-max game, a min-max optimization problem here for agent N. We impose some coupling constraints that guarantee that the local variables coincide between all the agents in the neighborhood. For that, we have introduced some slack variables, Q and P, which is very classical in this class of algorithms. What we have done is that we have gone a step further by expliciting rules to update primal variable and dual variable. So to update at each iteration the primal variable, we have to solve an optimization problem with only local constraints, and that we have formulated in an inexact setting. So the inexact formulation enables us to accelerate the speed of convergence of the algorithm. And to update the dual variable, we have a closed form expression that I've given here, which is also a guarantee that the algorithm will go faster. So under Lipschitz continuity of the gradient of the utility function of the agents, we have proved that the algorithm converges to a generalized Nash equilibrium, a solution of the bounded rationality game, GB. And this algorithm is parameterized, as I told before, in the vector of coefficients R of all the agents. We have now gone a step further on the analysis of the performance of the algorithm. So we assume an explicit form for the estimated coefficient that each agent N makes in front of the vector of decision of all the other agents. So we assume that the estimate is the sum of the true value of the coefficient plus an error term, which is here represented as a deterministic bias. And what we have done is that we have computed an upper bound on the distance between the strategy of the agents at equilibrium under incomplete information and the strategy of the agents at equilibrium under complete information. So if we go a step further, this gives us an upper bound on somehow the robustness of the algorithm that we have implemented. So now that we have solved the lower level of our hierarchical decomposition problem, we now go to the upper level. So as outcome of the algorithm I have introduced previously, we have a vector of primal variable and dual variables that are both parametrized in R, so the R vectors. And now we introduce a top level, an upper level, in which a principle defines a cost function G that captures some system-wide criterion, like, for example, cost, social cost, fairness. It can be also stability, measure of stability. So for fairness, we can use, for example, a Jens index. And the role of the principal will be to determine the value of the vector R such that we minimize this global cost criterion. So under convexity of the function G, and we prove that the algorithm converges, so it's an enumerative algorithm. And then, yeah, this gives the global overview of this hierarchical decomposition and how an equilibrium can be selected based on some system-wide properties. So I will now illustrate how a generalized Nash equilibrium problem can be applied to some energy-related problem and capture the impact of privacy in this specific setting. So we will focus on peer-to-peer energy trading. So this is a joint work with a number of colleagues that I've mentioned here. Here I've represented a platform that has been developed by Van den Broek in the Netherlands that put in relation prosumers that want to buy or trade surplus of energy. And as you can see, they can, based on their preference, decide with whom they want to trade their energy. And so there's a choice between over prosumers or renewable generators. And each one indicates the price at which they sell their energy. So I will detail the setting of our problem. So we have modeled the peer-to-peer energy trading market. We consider a set N of N agents that are prosumers. We define private information that is available at each agent level. So each agent defines a target demand, the N star, a rest generation, delta GN, that can, for example, come from solar PV panels. Decision variable of each agent are her self-generation, her demand, and the trade she agrees to put in place with her neighbors. So all the problem relies on the definition of a neighborhood for each agent. So this neighborhood is not necessarily connected with physical consideration. So it can be defined a priori by the agents. Like in the case of Van der Broek, each agent can decide with whom they would like to trade based on intrinsic preferences. So we now introduce the three parts that define the utility function of the agent N. There is first a part that deals with usage benefits. So it's a concave function that, that is maximized when the demand of the agents reach a target demand. Self-production cost, so it's a second order polynomial equation in the self-production cost. And total trading cost, which is a sum of the trade that agent N made with our neighbors inside the joint neighborhood, gamma N. And that is coefficiented by C values that somehow captures the preference that the agent N has about our neighbors. And these preferences can give rise to different interpretations, but the most meaningful in our setting is to interpret them as taxes defined a priori by some external regulator. So each agent N now has to solve a parameterized optimization problem in which he maximizes our utility function pi N by choosing demand, self-generation, the amount of energy to trade with our neighbors under local constraints or under demand generation. We also impose a capacity constraint on the energy trade with the neighbors and to somehow reflect what happens on the physical level. We have a bilateral trading reciprocity constraints that here is formulated for an inequality because we allow energy surplus within the economic network. And we have a final constraint which guarantees supply and demand balance at each node of the economic network. So associated with the bilateral trading reciprocity constraint, there is a dual variable zeta here that can be interpreted as the price for energy trading. By considering a couple of agents, N and M, this price might give rise to different valuation, and these different valuation themselves will give rise to the set of generalized Nash equilibrium. So what we have done is that we have proved analytically that every variational equilibrium solution of the generalized Nash equilibrium problem associated with this problem is economically efficient, which is an interesting property. We have no guarantee of uniqueness of the variational equilibrium. We have identified that the generalized Nash equilibrium problem as a potential structure, and we were able to reformulate the problem as a generalized potential game. with potential function and the sum of the utility of the agents. Because of this property, we know that classical best response algorithm, such as Gauss-Seidel, will converge to a solution of the generalized Nash equilibrium problem. So here, what we have done is that we have put in place a Gauss-Seidel best response algorithm. So it's a classical method, and the specificity of it is that it is sequential in its implementation, so which make it quite specific. And we have applied to a three-node toy network here, in which there are some finite capacity in the line joining the node. So in each node, there is a prosumer and trading with the others. And by changing the initial value of the Gauss-Seidel algorithm, we have generated three different equilibria. Two of them are generalized Nash equilibria that are not variational, and one of them is variational because it is indeed efficient. So this is like that we differentiate in this setting, variational equilibria from generalized Nash equilibria. So what is interesting when applying Gauss-Seidel best response algorithm is that we have been able to generate multiple solutions, but there are some limitations because it's difficult using this algorithm to really characterize the property of the algorithm, the equilibrium we generate. And also, it cannot be used to efficiently span a large number of equilibria. So this is why we have applied inexact ADMM, as introduced previously in my talk, to compute the set of all solutions of the problem. And as you can see here, the set of solution is infinite and gave rise to two components that are distant. So now we want to go a step further. We want to quantify the impact of private information on the generalized Nash equilibrium problem that we have introduced previously. Indeed, if you go back to the closed form expression of the equilibrium of the generalized Nash equilibrium problem in demand generation and net import, you can notice that each of these variables depends on the nodal price at the root node, which itself depends on a quantity y, which is the difference between the target demand of the agent and her self-generation. So typically, this quantity, the net demand of each agent, is not shared with the other agent. So this is a quantity that the agents want to keep private. So this means that if you want to explicitly compute the equilibrium, you need at some point to estimate this quantity. But if there are no information exchange on this quantity, it might be tricky to infer. So what we have done is that we have made the assumption that each agent anticipates the form of the equilibrium. So such an assumption has also been made by Fioretto et al. In the context of a Stackelbergian formulation. We make the additional hypothesis that the capacity of the line joining the root node and all the other nodes and the prosumer nodes are very large, even infinite, and that the preference between root node and prosumer nodes are symmetric, which are rather mild assumption. So the goal now is to design on top of the peer-to-peer energy trading market a decentralized communication mechanism in which each agent will decide on a report to give to the other agents. And this report is made of two parts, so a deterministic part and a random term, which is epsilon n, which is distributed according to a Gaussian density function. This is an assumption we made, centered in zero and with variance vn. So the goal of each agent is to determine the value of its deterministic report and variance such that it minimizes the difference between the profit with the modified values and the profit with truthful reports. And in addition to that, each agent defines some, has to hold some privacy constraints that are added to the problem. So we impose an upper bound on the distance between the truthful value of the report and the deterministic part of the report, such that the agents do not have too much incentive to deviate from the truthful value of the report, because it will create large inefficiencies in the market outcome. And we also impose an upper bound on the information that the agents release that is defined at the agent's level. And we quantify the quantity of information released by the agent by using Kullback-Leibler divergence. So what has been proved in our paper is that the generalized Nash equilibrium problem associated with this privacy problem has an aggregative game structure, which is nice. We derive the closed form expression of the privacy price, which depends explicitly on the difference between the deterministic part of the report that the agent makes and a truthful report. So the larger this quantity, the more the agents will be penalized, which is quite logic. And we were able to derive a variational formulation of the generalized Nash equilibrium problem, GP, by defining explicitly the associated operator, the pseudo-gradient matrix. And we notice that the operator is strongly monotone, which enables us to prove that the variational equilibrium solution of this problem is unique. To compute the variational equilibrium, we have applied.
Ask a quick question about the formulation of this private game. So if you just go back two slides back, yes, here. So I see that those stochastic constraints, right, they're enforced using expectation operator, right? And also I see that this noise epsilon, right, has a zero mean distribution. So I just assume that the outcome of this game would be the same as a deterministic game without the noise. Is it the case?
Without the noise?
Because constraints are enforced for expected value, mm-hmm. right? Which is basically zero.
Yes. But I think the agents can still have incentives to deviate using the deterministic part of the report. Mm-hmm. So even if there is a zero noise, they can still deviate through this deterministic part.
Okay.
Though the structure of the game will be the same as the one we analyzed before, but it might be different from the truthful report. I mean, they might increase their profits by choosing to bias deterministically their report.
All right. Thank you.
So we apply a diffusion, then adapt, then penalize algorithm, which is a two-stage algorithm for stochastic generalized Nash equilibrium computation. It's quite classical. So what we have done here is that we have represented the utility gap for each agent, and we have implemented the algorithm for a 13-bus network coming from IEEE. And we have represented this utility gap as a function of the upper bound on the maximum deviation that the agent is allowed to choose regarding the deterministic part of his report, alpha, and the maximum information she agrees to release. So what we can see is logically, as we increase these bounds, the agents have incentives and to deviate from their truthful reports. So there is clearly a trade-off between utility maximization and privacy. We also observe that some agents wins and some lose. So this might create some fairness issues in this setting that can be tricky also to quantify. And on top of that, we observe that some free rider behavior might appear, meaning that some agents might choose very small upper bound on the information they want to release. So they might not want to release lots of private information, but still they might increase their utility, meaning that at some point they profit of the information released by the other agents to increase their own profit, who they have not released themselves lots of private information. So this might impact the way this communication mechanism is implemented, and detection of free rider behavior might be an issue. So to conclude my talk, so parameterizing exact ADMM that I have introduced previously in the first part of my talk is a relevant algorithm to generate multiple generalized Nash equilibria. We have to go a step further and to be able to span the full set of equilibria by accelerating and the way the space of the air vector is spanned. A normalized Nash equilibrium is a relevant solution concept to a select equilibrium in the framework of coordination game. The convergence of the algorithm is guaranteed under a rather mild assumption, which is also interesting. As next steps, we want to quantify how much information to reveal by the agents to reach a generalized Nash equilibrium with desirable properties. So I mean by instead of putting in place a principle that will choose the air vector and force the algorithm to converge to a specific equilibrium with a desirable property, the idea will be to design some incentives forcing the agents or encouraging them to reveal their information, and then somehow forcing the system to converge with equilibrium with desirable properties. Another line of research is to not use proximal or variance of proximal method, but instead model bounded rational agents as adversarial learning agents and rely on the learning literature to build an algorithm to compute generalized Nash equilibria and span many of equilibria. And finally, a last line of research, because as you have seen, solving this bounded rationality game has been done in a hierarchical decomposition setting. So what would be interesting is to make the link between this hierarchical decomposition and a generic approach to solve Stackelberg game that involve, for example, one leader, multiple followers, and that are generally quite tricky to solve. So thank you for your attention. I have given here a list of papers that are related to the different results that I've presented and that will give you more information about the result we obtained.
Great, thank you. Thank you so much. Now it's time for questions. So feel free to unmute yourself and ask your questions.
Dr. Lakat, I have a question.
Yes.
Given that your solution depends on the dual information of the coupling constraint, do you think if we had integer variables in the coupling constraint, is it possible to use the duality of linear programming to formulate or solve this problem?
No, I think that would require, I mean, if you have such a setting, that would require to use another algorithm. It is not directly, it cannot directly be extended to this setting. So in the setting that we studied here, we make the assumption that the coupling constraints are linear, eh? There is no integral variables. So if we relax this assumption, I mean, it's a completely different setting, and even the bound the convergence rate that we derived will change. So, I mean, it requires completely a completely different approach and updating of all the performance results.
Okay, I see.
I was also wondering about this hierarchical optimization. So, mm-hmm. when you actually show like the structure of this problem. I could mm-hmm. see that the inexact ADMM algorithm, it was a lower level problem, right? And there was an upper level problem that tries to find this parameterization R, right?
Mm-hmm.
And I was just curious if this inexact ADMM, I mean, do you need inexact ADMM for this problem? Or is there some centralized optimizations that can replace this block in this scheme?
So the block here?
Yes.
Yeah. This is in line with what I've said before. So the problem here, we propose to use inexact ADMM because we want to have an algorithm that can be applied to very specific form of generalized Nash equilibrium problems. If you have a potential structure in your non-cooperative game, Of course, here you can replace this algorithm by a standard optimization algorithm. But in many cases, potential structure does not happen, or you need to put use some trick by adding, for example, a regularization parameters or terms to arrive to this potential structure. But in many games, you don't have neither a potential nor aggregative nor. So we want it here to design an algorithm that can be applied to any class of game of non-cooperative game.
I see. And if we talk about application, does it mean that if you use a distributed algorithm as a low-level problem, does it mean that your hierarchical optimization is also fully distributed, that you can actually run it without information sharing?
For me, it's fully distributed in the way we compute the equilibrium parameterized in R. But since we need to make a principle intervene in the problem at the upper level, for me it's not anymore. So the hierarchical decomposition, it gives rise to a global algorithm, which is not anymore fully distributed. I would say it's semi-decentralized now in this formulation. But one idea might be indeed to get rid of this principle to compute the error, and as I said in the next steps, put in place some incentive for information sharing, such that we can enforce a fully distributed design.
Yes. No, maybe what I meant is not fully distributed, but at least decentralized, right? Or
like yes, it's semi-decentralized. Yeah. It's semi-decentralized here. Yes.
Exactly. Oh, this is wonderful. And also, I was caught by the privacy part of your algorithm very much. And I was actually thinking, is there any connection to differential privacy in this work? Because, yes, I see that you achieve privacy through randomization of the computation at hand, right? And I also recall this definition of differential privacy, where you basically add noise to obfuscate input data set. But in differential privacy, I think what they do, they actually choose the parameters of this noise to respect exactly what the parameters they try to hide, right?
And
in your case, like, do you calibrate the parameters of the noise, or how does it work in your case?
Yeah, I mean, in the application I presented, the noise is distributed according to a Gaussian density function, and I mean it's centered in zero, and the variance it's a decision variable of each agent. So the initial idea was to use differential privacy, but it had a big impact on the game properties. It was not anymore aggregative in terms of structure. So we found it too complex to put it in place here. I know there are related papers, and I cited one of them that use this differential privacy setting. That might also be an extension, but in the current status of our work, we have not considered differential privacy.
All right. Because the parallel that can be here is that if the variance is a decision variable in this case, right, then it basically translates into privacy parameters, because the more privacy an agent has, the more variance it assigns, right? Mm-hmm. So it's basically optimizing a privacy budget versus utility loss, right? Mm-hmm. So it's a very interesting problem.
Yeah. Yes.
All right, so do we have more questions from the audience? So please feel free to unmute yourself and ask your question. All right, it looks like we are done here. So thank you, Helen, one more time for giving this amazing talk. And thanks everyone for joining. So, yes, I think we can call it the end.
Okay, thank you very much.